It has already been part of the court record. It is a public record that you can view. Therefore, I will not read the plea agreement at this time. But there are two portions of the plea agreement that are significant for this sentencing proceeding. The first is that there is an agreement that any uncharged victims may be allowed to testify. In this case, there are 13 counts of criminal sexual conduct against three victims. Some of those charges are being dismissed at the time of sentencing today pursuant to the plea agreement. But there are other individuals who have come forward and who have been the victims of this defendant. Instead of the Attorney General amending the information or having to file new charges against the defendant, the agreement was that at the time of sentencing, uncharged individuals, victims, would be able to make a victim impact statement. The other part of the plea agreement that is significant has to do with sentencing. The defendant and the Attorney General have reached an agreement that the minimum sentence for this defendant shall be between 25 and 40 years. The court will make a determination of what that will be at the conclusion of the sentencing hearing. Now, if the court does not follow a plea agreement, then either side may withdraw from that agreement, and the next step would be to have a trial. The court is choosing to follow that plea agreement, and that is what we are going to do. So now as we begin the sentencing procedure, the court has received from the Attorney General a pre-sentencing legal memorandum. That memorandum is a public record. It outlines facts and law, and it tells the court what the Attorney General would like the court to do at the conclusion of the sentencing. The court is also in receipt of what's called a pre-sentence investigation report. This document is prepared in every criminal proceeding for the sentencing of a felon. It is prepared by the Michigan Department of Corrections, and it gives the court information that I am required to consider by law, and it also prepares the scoring of the sentencing guidelines. I've received it and I have read it. Now, Mr. Newberg, have you had an opportunity to review the pre-sentencing agreement with your client?
We have, Your Honor.
Do you have any modifications to that agreement?
No modifications.
Would you like to inquire of your client?
Thank you, Your Honor. Mr. Nassar, we entered into a plea agreement with your employer, is that correct? And you want the court to follow that plea agreement today? And you believe the statements you made in that plea agreement were accurate? You need to speak up just a little bit.
Okay.
And you had the opportunity to ask your counsel, myself, Ms. Smith, and Ms. Blythe, any questions you had as it related to the plea agreement? And you want the court to follow that plea agreement, right?
Thank you. Mr. Newberg, do you have any objection to the scoring of the guidelines?
None.
Ms. Pavlia, same questions to you. Any modifications to the pre-sentence investigation report?
Good morning, Angela Pavlidis on behalf of the people. For the record, we have no additions, deletions, or corrections, and we also agree with the report and Mr. Newberg that the guidelines are accurately scored.
Thank you very much. All right, the court has also received numerous victim statements in this case. Some of the victims have chosen not to be identified, and the court will make sure that their identity is not disclosed. Prior to formally starting these proceedings, I have talked to the media, and they understand that, and will make sure that that does not happen. Some of the individuals have submitted written statements, but do want to appear in court and not be identified. We will make sure that does not happen. Some of the individuals have submitted written statements and do wish to address the court in person. We are now at that stage in the proceedings. Would you please invite the first individual up?
I will, Your Honor, just as a housekeeping matter, I wanted the court to know that the current number of victim impact statements to be read or read on behalf of here in court is currently at 65. I do expect that that number may change, but that's the current number we are at as of this moment. Also, for the record, Your Honor, you've noticed that I have a screen set up and a projector. We will be displaying photographs of the victims when they come to the podium to give their statement. And these are photographs of these women at the age of the abuse. This is demonstrative evidence only. I'm not asking to put this into the record, but just for your benefit as you review and hear them.
Thank you. That will be beneficial.
You know, the first victims you will hear from today are charged victims, specifically victim A here in both Ingham and Eaton County. She has determined that she would like to be publicly identified. She is a minor. Her parents have consented to her being publicly identified and are present in court should you wish to voir dire them regarding that. She was publicly identified previously when she spoke in Ingham County as well and voir dired there as well, and that is Jessica Tomasho.
I think that for our record, I would like at least one of the parents, if you would like to voir dire them, or I can, to indicate that they do give their consent for the minor to be identified publicly.
Which would you prefer? I can defer to you, or I can, it's really, doesn't matter to me.
Let's have the parent come forward.
Your Honor, accompanying Jessica is her father, Mike Tomasho, Michael Tomasho.
Mr. Tomasho, you are Jessica's father, is that correct?
Yes.
And she is a minor, correct?
Yes.
You understand that she has the right not to be identified in any way during these legal proceedings?
Yes.
And as her father and as her guardian, do you give permission that she may be identified in these proceedings?
Yeah, both I do and my wife does.
Thank you. Thank you very much for being here.
You know, I have displayed on the screen a photograph of Jessica at the time of the abuse. Her parents also brought with them to court today a photograph of her during her gymnastics competition. I believe she's roughly the age of 10, and she was a Twist Stars gymnast as well. So I'll let Jessica speak.
Hello.
Good morning.
Do I just start?
Yes.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Honorable Judge Cunningham, thank you for giving me this opportunity to read to you my victim impact statement and tell you how being sexually assaulted by Larry Nassar has affected my life. I am Jessica Tomasho. I'm 17 and a senior in high school. I am victim A in both Eaton County and Ingham County criminal cases. I was sexually assaulted by Larry Nassar when I was 9 and 12 years old. Before I start my story, I want to take a minute to thank the people in my world that have been there for me. My mom and dad, my sisters Amanda and Kat, and my closest friends. I have also been blessed to have an amazing legal team, Assistant AG Angela Povilaitis, Sergeant Andrea Mumford, Attorney Stephen Drew, Judge Allen, Judge Renke, Judge Aquilina, and you, Judge Cunningham. You are my people, and I thank you. No high schooler should ever have to know the inside of a courtroom as well as I do. I've been in court 8 times now, including 2 preliminary hearings when I was cross-examined about every single detail of what Larry Nassar did to me when he sexually assaulted me. While I have tried to be strong, it's been hard, and I have broken down with the memories and cried many times. In court, one of my worst moments was when Larry Nassar and his legal team laughed at me during my testimony.
Our victim impact statements. If she wants to talk about these statements or the things that the defendant did to her and how that's impacted her moving forward, that's fine. Statements about the legal team and what we did and the job that we did, I don't think is appropriate for them. But here, I know we went through this in Ingham County, but I'm just going to place an objection on the record. Thank you.
I know that this is very hard, and I really appreciate you being here today, and I definitely want to hear your story. But we should limit it to how you have been impacted and the thing about Mr. Nassar as opposed to his
okay.
attorneys. But I have read your statement,
mm-hmm.
and I know that that's really all you were going to say
yeah.
anyway, so we can move on. But for any other individuals that will be addressing the court, comments about a defense attorney or things that have happened in that regard are not the proper subject matter for sentencing. The sentencing is to give me information about how the individual was impacted by the criminal conduct of Larry Nassar.
Okay.
But thank you. Go ahead.
Okay. This has been harder than I ever imagined, and I couldn't have done it without all of your support. Thank you for being my rocks and helping me every step along the way with this ugly battle. Larry Nassar is evil. He first molested me when I was 9, when I was in 5th grade, before I had braces, and when I still played with my American Girl dolls. He created the physical and emotional pain that comes with sexual trauma, pain that I have to this day. While this is my story, I also know that there are over 200 more victims like me out there. I heard many of their stories last week, and from what I can tell, we have all been traumatized and feel the pain of abuse. In addition, some victims, like me, also have anxiety and PTSD, and the trauma has created deep mental anguish. In others, the trauma has resulted in depression, eating disorders, self-harm, alcoholism, and I know of one victim that tragically committed suicide. Larry Nassar preyed on us for his own pleasure, leaving in his wake traumatized and broken girls, transforming us from sweet, trusting children into victims fighting to reclaim our lives. Judge Cunningham, I think you will see in my statement and all the other victims' statement that Larry Nassar is a criminal of the worst kind, a cunning, methodical, serial child molester, and I hope you sentence him to behind bars for the rest of his miserable life. Thinking back, my childhood was filled with happiness and love, including my love for gymnastics. My gym was Gedart Twistars, and it had a strong program for young competitive gymnasts. In 2nd grade, I became a team member and a member of USA Gymnastics. I competed in local and regional meets for the next 6 years. Twistars also had its own sports medicine physician, Larry Nassar, in sight to provide medical care for injured gymnasts. The way it worked at Twistars is that if you were injured, you were specifically instructed to see Larry Nassar, not your family doctor. In turn, he told our coaches what we could do in the gym, and he made up our treatment plan. At Twistars, at the upper levels, just about everyone was treated sooner or later by Larry Nassar. He was a major asset for Twistars. He not only saw and treated injured gymnasts, he helped Twistars' reputation in recruitment because of who he was. A MSU sports medicine faculty physician and the USA Gymnastics team doctor. As with other gymnasts, the physical demand of gymnastics left me with a series of painful injuries. I remember one of my first injuries, a rib misplacement. This was the first time I heard of Larry Nassar and his reputation. I remember telling my mom that my coaches told me I should see Nassar for my injury, and to my surprise, she knew who he was. She had trained under him when she went to medical school at Michigan State University. One night, my coaches arranged for me to see Nassar after practice to help with my rib injury. Monday nights were when Nassar came to Twistars to treat injured team gymnasts. I remember my coaches telling me to go see him, and I was actually quite excited. Then I went into the back room, and that's when everything changed. I was alone with him. He had me lie down on the table, and he sexually assaulted me. He touched the most innocent places on my body that day. I remember fear and pain and asking myself, what is happening? When it was over, I was so confused. What had he just done to me and why? It was awful and embarrassing, but I did not question the procedure. I was 9. He was a famous sports medicine doctor, and I assumed the gross thing he did would help me get better. 2 years passed. I saw him several times again at his clinic at MSU, always with my mom, and they were normal appointments. Thinking back, because she is a doctor, my mom probably saved me from abuse at those appointments. She was curious about the procedure, and she asked him to remove the towel so she could see exactly where his hands were touching me. He did not abuse me in her presence. But in 2012, it happened again, right around my 12th birthday. I had a stress fracture in my ankle, and my dad took me to that appointment. Before Nassar assaulted me, we had a great, meaningful conversation about my future. He asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up, and I said, I want to be just like you, a sports medicine doctor. He gave me a gift, a pin from the Olympics, and told me, when you take my place as the new sports medicine doctor for gymnastics, then you can give me back this pin. Nassar then told my dad he had to massage me and it would be okay for him to wait in the waiting room. After my dad left, Nassar told the medical student to leave the room too. He then had me change into baggy shorts. After the room was cleared, he did it yet again, but this time it was even worse. He slid his ungloved hand up my leg and back into the most innocent part of my body, and I felt searing pain. This time, for 30 minutes, he inserted his finger into me and grunted while I lay there terrified. Again, I was confused by what had just happened. He was a trusted doctor, and what he did to me didn't make sense in my child's mind. Doctors help you get better, don't they? I just figured that he was helping me, and as a good gymnast, I just had to gut out the pain. I tried not to think about it anymore, but my dream of becoming a sports medicine doctor died that day. I lived the next year, several years in limbo. Being sexually assaulted has changed me into an anxious teen, but I did not know that I had been abused and that this was the source of my anxiety. I no longer felt safe, and I had problems with trust. My parents took me to a psychiatrist and a therapist when I was in ninth grade, and this helped. I was diagnosed with and treated for social anxiety disorder and saw a therapist on a weekly basis, but still did not have insight into the cause. In the seventh and eighth grade, I felt extremely uncomfortable around my male teachers. I avoided them. I hated talking to them, and I would feel panic if I ever was alone in a room with them. But then I didn't understand why I felt this way, because all of my peers loved our teachers. But being sexually assaulted affected my relationship with my teachers, and my anxiety was so intense that it made it hard to focus and learn at school. I also developed an intense fear of male hands, like a PTSD response. Now I get flashbacks when I see male hands, and it makes me feel scared and threatened. This fear changed the way I grew up and how I related to boys. I did not want to hold hands or be even close to my guy friends. I couldn't be just a normal girl anymore, and I forever lost a big piece of my childhood due to his abuse. When the first Indy Star article came out, my life changed. I put the pieces together and realized I was molested by Larry Nassar, and I immediately told my parents. I thought back to my appointments with him and could still feel what my 9 and 12-year-old self felt then. Alone, scared, and in pain. I wanted to puke. I could feel his hands touching me, and this was the first time I had a flashback. And to this day, I still have them. The flashbacks are paralyzing. I had one just a few weeks ago at school, and I could barely get out of my seat. Thankfully, I was able to stop my brain, and I went to the office. I cried for an hour, shaking with fear. I would like to say something to my abuser, Larry Nassar. You took advantage of my innocence and trust. You were my doctor. Why? I ask myself that question all the time, especially while I am laying in bed crying myself to sleep. What you did to me was twisted. You manipulated me and my entire family. How dare you? You had no right to do that. Because of your decision to molest me, you have caused me so much pain in my life, and for the rest of my life, I'm going to have to heal from what you did. Your Honor, I understand that the plea guidelines are for a minimum sentence range of 25 to 40 years, and I ask you to give Larry Nassar the minimum 40-year sentence for what he did to me. I also ask on behalf of what he did to over 200 other girls. We are all suffering from the trauma of sexual abuse, and our victims' statements show that it created deep wounds. Anxiety, depression, PTSD, substance abuse, eating disorders, self-harm, problems at school and work and in relationships, wounds needing lots of therapy and real doctor appointments to heal. We are all in pain, having flashbacks, unable to have normal relationships, crying at night, feeling broken, and our lives have been forever changed. He is a predator, and he can't be stopped unless he is behind bars for the rest of his life. Thank you.
Jessica, thank you very much for being here today. I agree with you. Nobody in high school should be standing there.
Yes.
I do hope that the process of writing down what happened and how it made you feel,
mm-hmm.
which, by the way, was very articulate, and then speaking here today helps you as part of the healing process.
Yes.
I will definitely take your statement into consideration in fashioning a sentence, and I thank you for being here today.
Thank you.
Your Honor, the next victim survivor that you will hear from has previously been identified anonymously. I want to confirm with Herb again before I say her name and place her photograph, but she is okay with that. She has decided to be identified publicly, and
is this victim 105?
This is Eaton County Charged Victim C. Her name is Annie LaBrie.
Thank you. Ms. Provolitis, you might want to pour a cup of water so there's water there for the individuals making statements, because
yes.
I think when we get nervous, we get a dry throat. Oh, she has her water. That's okay. All right.
Yeah, sorry about
all right.
This.
You know, she, Annie has her friend Rachel, who is her support person here with her to give her impact statement, and I have displayed her photograph at the age of abuse.
Okay. All right. Originally, I was absolutely certain I would not be delivering an impact statement. Last summer, I testified against Larry in court at a time when he was still widely supported. It induced a level of stress previously unknown to me, and had it not been for the encouragement of my friends, family, and the work of the valiant women who have dedicated their sweat and tears to winning this case, I don't know that I would have had the strength. I thought speaking today might bring back the trauma of that experience, and it still may. I was afraid to open an old wound, to yet again pour some of my most triggering and intimate realities out in front of this man, in front of you all. I was afraid I'd sound redundant, that I had nothing to say that hadn't already been said. I was afraid of vulnerability, of judgment, and I was afraid to fail. But then I remembered that there is power in numbers, and that each and every one of us has something important to contribute to this conversation, to this movement. It is impossible to say it all in one statement, but I can try. I was a full-time gymnast for the entirety of my adolescence. I divided my life between Spring Lake and Lansing, spending 25 hours plus a week at Gettert's Twisters, not including the hour and a half commute one way. Like we all did, I sacrificed a normal high school experience, if there is such a thing, in hopes of success. I did my homework and ate 2 of 3 meals in a car, functioned on minimal sleep, pushed through constant physical pain alongside pressure to excel both academically and athletically. Larry was my doc for 5 years. When I was 15, I crashed hard at practice and severely injured my back. I suffered spasms so painful there were instances in which I couldn't get out of my desk after class. My legs would go numb occasionally, sometimes in the middle of tricks at practice. I began seeking treatment from Larry more regularly, at Twistars, at MSU, and in the basement of his home. Despite the constant visits and my coach's knowledge of my pain, I was made to push through practice and competitions because that's what you do in gymnastics. Ultimately, it took a year for this world-renowned doctor to discover the compression fracture in the growth plate of my spine. My back still hurts every single day. Okay, here's where I could tell you about the treatments, about how they made my skin crawl, how I rejected my intuition anyway, because every adult and authority figure around me assured me that he was the only option. I could tell you about how I told some of my teammates without really telling them, how we all did. How I hid it from my parents because, in Larry's words, they wouldn't understand. I could tell you about how a few years later, I was flooded with shame, guilt, confusion. How I felt I'd been violated but was stifled by an inability to comprehend that this as a reality, as my reality, because how could someone so distinguished and trustworthy commit such an intrusive act of violence again and again and again? I could tell you about what followed, the panic attacks, the nightmares, the desperate desire to tuck it all away to never be recovered. I could tell you about how it wreaked havoc on my relationship with my parents. How I've pushed my mother away when all she's ever wanted was to be my rock.
Take your time.
My urgency here today, though, is to address what allowed an atrocity of this scale to occur. Here's the thing. As detectives, attorneys, and survivors have previously noted, a pedophile cannot flourish in the way Larry did in an environment that is not conducive to his behavior. While justice has been served for the sexual predator, it is imperative that we as a society do not view this as an isolated incident. He was prolific because surrounding authorities allowed him to be, because the gymnastics world allowed him to be, because still women are not perceived to be credible. Gymnastics, and to my knowledge, sports like dance and figure skating, functions within a very specific culture, one in which young girls face a virgin whore dichotomy, where we had to be pure, innocent, perfect, while simultaneously over-sexualized before we even understood what that meant or the weight that it carries. Crude comments, inappropriate remarks on our bodies, incredibly uncomfortable situations, consistently creepy men towering over us, the pressure of narrow Eurocentric beauty standards, etc. I could go on. Our bodies did not belong to us. Our experiences, physical and emotional, were constantly invalidated, and we learned early on not to question authority, to not expect respect from men. We were quite literally judged for our every move, every hair out of place, every ounce of fat carried by our overworked muscles. The strict demand to be thin alongside the enforcement of unhealthy dieting led to an alarming rate of disordered eating and lasting battles with body image. Coaching by fear, intimidation, shame, and explicit favoritism was the norm. While I was not treated nearly as poorly as many of my teammates, I witnessed the horrors endured by others, and that alone is enough to stand against it. This is why it comes as no surprise to me that Larry was able to continue his practices for as long as he did. We'd been conditioned for years to obey at all costs. How could we have been expected to question his authority, his treatment? And how could anyone have expected those coaches who psychologically damaged us with their cutting words, their misogynistic degradations, their utter dismissal of our emotions, emotional and physical needs, to protect us from other forms of abuse? My mother once told me, if a boyfriend ever treats you the way John does, leave him. As an adult with my own agency, I now know that a coach shouldn't treat you that way either. It is important to note that not all gyms are like this. I completed my last year as a club gymnast at age 17 at R Athletics in Grand Rapids, a gym run by women for women, and as far as running around in annoying leotards, inhaling chalk, obsessively practicing frightening and painful tricks, it was absolute bliss. My time spent at this gym was a reminder that gymnastics could be fun, productive, healthy, that discipline, hard work, and ultimately success can exist without the presence of fear, intimidation, and abuse. The unfortunate reality of this, however, is that our athletics is a rare gem. In my opinion, though, it is the only way to practice gymnastics. The rest is unacceptable. My experience as a gymnast is my own and may or may not be unique to many others, but it is my truth. My purpose in delivering this statement is not to seek revenge, but rather to raise awareness, to address the issues I faced as a young gymnast, the issues that in part drove me to pursue social justice and women's studies in academia. My hope is to create a safer space for young gymnasts and to encourage those within the sport and otherwise to speak up. The years I spent at Twistar as a Twistar's gymnast made it clear to me that Gettert's gym practiced an overall lack of respect for women. While I do believe John and many coaches like him possess some level of affinity for their gymnasts, we simply were not valued as the individuals we were, but rather vehicles to his personal road to success. By extension, when numerous adults refused to believe Larry's victims, when MSU and USAG refused to listen to those who came forward long ago, when some continue to espouse abuse in the defense of a mere sport, this is a direct reflection of the patriarchal system in which we all function today. This is what makes the Nassar trial bigger than gymnastics. At some point throughout this tumultuous journey, I lost my self-worth. The first 18 years of my life had become convoluted and painful. I resorted to self-destruction and self-harm. But if nothing else, I've learned that life is incredibly fragile, and I refuse to do anything other than live my truth. After all the years I spent searching for success in gymnastics, I now know that I have found some sense of success in participating in this powerful movement to enact change both within the sport of gymnastics and in society as a whole. Young athletes, young girls, women, know that you have a voice, that you are allowed to listen to your emotions and body, that you are enough. In 3 weeks, I'll be moving to Seoul, South Korea to start a new job. I will never not be an advocate for social justice, but all of this hurt, I plan to leave right here behind me. This is the end of my destruction. This is my new beginning. Thank you.
Well, Annie, thank you so much for being here. The reasons that you gave, perhaps the trepidations of why you didn't want to come forward, I think are very common. I'm glad that you did come forward, but I do want to assure you there is no redundancy in your statement. Each individual that makes a statement is unique and has a unique story. There may be similarities in the criminal acts that Nassar performed, but there is no redundancy. And I wish you the best of luck in South Korea, did you say?
Yes.
Good luck to you, and thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Your Honor, the next survivor statement you will hear from is going to be read on behalf of that victim. It is victim B here in Eaton County. Her name is Bailey Lawrenson, and she is present in the courtroom today with her father and mother, but she has asked us to read it on her behalf. She did speak last week in Ingham County, and Ms. Liddell will be reading that statement. And I do have a photograph of Bailey as well.
Your Honor, I am here today, previously known as Victim B, to tell my story of the abuse that was put on me during my childhood. I feel that many of the things I'm going to say are similar to what has already been said by 100 other survivors. We cannot let that dilute the importance of each of our stories. Most importantly, Larry, I don't want you to forget each and every one of us who came before you to tell the world what you have done to us. I know you have heard it, but now you are hearing it from me, and I wanted to hit you just as hard as the others. You wrote a pitiful letter, mistakenly thinking that Judge Aquilina would actually care that you had concerns of being able to mentally handle 4 days of victim impact statements. Maybe you should have thought of that before you selfishly decide to molest all of us. What about our mental state, having to go through all of this not only for the 4 days of listening to each other's tragic stories, but for the rest of our lives? How dare you think anyone cares about your mental state at this point? And here we are, we made it through those 4 days, still listening to me now. I sure as hell know that my mental state wasn't ready for something like this. But while my mind heals and filters out that evil sickness you bestowed upon my body, your mind will get darker and darker, and you will hate yourself as much as the world hates you now. I hope that you remember how strong we looked up here while we stood with our army and the world behind us as you sat, unable to speak, in a room full of people who despise your existence. You should get used to what this feels like, because no one is no longer listening to anything you have to say, and you're manipulating lies. You've ruined and compromised so many young women, and now we are here to ruin you. It's like Kyle said, we don't stay little girls forever, Larry, and I'm certain that you and your mental state will never forget that. My story with Larry started when I was in the fourth grade during a 2-day training at Twistars. As I was getting higher in level, it was inevitable that injuries were to be more prone. My parents were told about this incredible world-renowned doctor who came to our gym for free every Monday night. He was the doctor to see. I wasn't allowed to see anyone else. It was highly suggested to see Larry and not to see my family physician. And when things are suggested at Twistars, that means it's mandatory. It started with simple shin splints and forearm splints and minor injuries like these. He was nice, instantly talking to me like he had known me forever. I did not really get to know him well until about the sixth grade, when I fell from the high bar at approximately 8 to 9 feet, landing directly on my head, breaking my neck in 4 places in my C1 and C2. John Getter came over to me after this fall as I laid there in pain, and he asked me to sit up. and I could hardly manage on my own, so he helped me upright and felt along my spine. With competition season ahead, he proceeded to tell me that it was probably a muscle injury. He then told me to ice and finish the next 2 hours of practice in the splits. At the end of practice, my teammates had to help me dress, and I went home. Later, I laid on the couch and could not get myself back up, so my parents rushed me to the hospital, only to find out that I was lucky not to have been paralyzed, especially after being moved immediately after my fall. The doctor at the hospital explained to me that one little shift the wrong way when I stood up or sat in those splits could cause paralysis, and I was a miracle. This story in detail is not only important to highlight the negligence of John Gettard, but to draw a map for how Larry found my weaknesses and found out how he could get on my side and gain my trust. I remember when Larry heard what happened, he consoled me and told me how angry he was with John. He explained to me that he did not follow protocol by not immediately calling an ambulance for me. He told me that he was going to yell at him about how he handled my fall and make sure that he never did this again. I felt like Larry was my hero. He was going to yell at John for mishandling me. He then expressed how sorry he was for what happened, and we exchanged numbers in case I ever needed anything. From then on, he always asked me how John was treating me. And I thought you really cared, Larry. I thought you were on my side those nights when John was so awful to me. I thought you cared about the abuse he inflicted on us. You knew about it all along because we would come to you, but his abuse was your fuel. You used his abuse to mask your own pathetic pleasure. You used my childlike vulnerability as your access to gain my trust in you. This is something I will never forget. It is clear that in an environment like Twistar's, a monster like Nassar could thrive. He just had to be the nice guy so that all these young girls would look at him as the savior in that safe place at the gym. This was the tactic he used, and now my trust in good people has escaped me. Now, when an older male is being nice to me in any way, my heart starts to pound and I begin to sweat, hardly being able to focus because my mind is jumping around whether I could trust this man or what his intentions actually are for him being so nice to me. Now, when I feel an older man looks at me in the eye, I think he is thinking of me in a sexual way. But this is just the anxiety that you have caused, and I realize this. I realize they are not you, and I believe someday I will have better control over those anxieties with time. After I broke my neck and I was out of gymnastics for about 8 months, I then completed the next 2.5 years, and in the 8th grade, going to the 9th grade, I began to have major lower back problems. I expressed my pain to John, but it was never enough. It was to the point that if I fell and something internal was hurting, I would hope to God that I were bruised just to have visible proof that I was hurting so that he would believe me. I did a tumbling pass during my floor routine and landed on my face due to my back giving me so much pain. John got in my face, screaming, telling me to do sprints on the vault runway as I was visibly limping from the pain. Later that night, I saw Larry and vented to him about what had happened. I then had an MRI and was sure enough my back was broken at my lumbar 5. I was put in a back brace for the next year. And I may point out that at that time, there are at least 8 more of my teammates in back braces as well. I don't think other gyms would have looked at this as normal. This is where my sexual abuse started. I remember the first time it happened, you were massaging my back as normal, and then without warning or explanation, you stuck your ungloved fingers into my vagina. While it was happening, you said it was a medical treatment that would help my back. You closed your eyes and continued talking to me like nothing was happening. But for me, a lot was happening in my mind. No one had ever touched me like this before. I thought to myself, aren't my parents supposed to give you consent first? It's the gymnastics world, though things aren't by the book, plus they wouldn't understand. But isn't it weird that he's not wearing gloves? I wonder if he does this to other girls. Why is he closing his eyes? He's a doctor, though. I'm sure it's fine. Plus, he's Larry. He's been so nice to me, and someone with his name I can obviously trust, right? I was so uncomfortable the whole time I didn't know how to act. I was just wondering when he was going to be finished. When you finally did stop, I couldn't wait to leave and go talk to my friends. I asked them right away, and they reassured me that it happened to them too. but still at every appointment I dreaded it because of the uncomfortable feeling of what was going on. But I figured I was at Twistars, and this was supposed to be a safe place. Larry was the guy I could vent to and trust with anything, and he made it seem like he would do anything he could to help me, even inviting me into his own home. Just because I did not like the treatment, it did not mean that it shouldn't have been done. That's what I thought to be true. He said it. He said it was the very best way to fix my back. But my back never felt any better, and it got to the point that I told you it felt better just so I did not have to sit on that table with your fingers in my vagina anymore. Maybe if I told you it was better, you would just rub my back and give me the exercises instead. But even when my back never healed, you told me in the doctor's office at MSU that you dropped the ball on me and that you let me slip under your radar. And unfortunately, if I wanted to be able to walk someday, that I had to quit gymnastics. The saddest part is that you telling me I needed to quit was music to my ears. I finally had a good enough reason to tell John that I quit without him pressuring me or making me feel like I did not have a choice. I would finally not have to have your treatments anymore. I was free, and it was over for me. And now look at me up here dropping the ball on you, but I have definitely not let you slip under my radar. Looking back now as a woman, I am appalled at what my child self went through. I have had people close to me ask me why I never told anyone, or act surprised or confused that no one ever spoke up to these people. And I want to say to them, how dare you? How dare you have the audacity to ask anyone such a shaming question? No one ever has the right to ask a victim of sexual abuse why they didn't say anything. Unless it's happened to you, have the common sense to know that it is none of your business. Unless it's happened to you, you probably wouldn't understand anyway. For the last draining year and a half, I've had to sit behind my computer quietly watching as old teammates and parents of teammates supported Larry and said that we were lying. It took 37,000 child pornographic images for people to believe you and wonder why no one told on you. But then as the story expanded, we found out that multiple people did tell. MSU, they told USAG, and John Gettard, and yet nothing was done. And again I say, you wonder why we kept our mouth shut? I can tell you, I told my sister, and she thought it was very weird, but she wasn't as brainwashed as I was. I told her not to tell anyone, not even my parents. I knew no one would understand, and I need to get better with when I was in pain. Unless you were a gymnast, no one understands the gymnastics world. Unless you knew Larry, you didn't understand the way he acted as our savior. Things weren't always by the book in my gymnastic days. You did what you were told. You see who you're supposed to see. You don't talk back. You have no questions. So this so-called amazing doctor that you are supposed to have, you feel lucky to do so. I figured John knew we were his athletes in his gym. He was supposed to know that what Larry was doing to us. He was supposed to discuss our treatments with him. Instead, he wasn't even there. He was on his way home while we stayed in the gym, sometimes until midnight, to be molested one by one unknowingly. How irresponsible, how selfish, and how neglectful. What this has done to me since the news has broken. I've always had perfectionist problems. It is an overwhelming anxiety that takes hold of me when I don't do something right or when I don't perform perfectly on something like a test. The mind games I play on myself, bullying myself until I cry myself to sleep, feeling incompetent, uprooting through my past with gymnastics. But since this has came out, I noticed that my control over this has gotten much worse. I have kept many of my struggles through this quiet and to myself, crying myself to sleep often more times than I want to admit. Trying to remember more that I can understand myself as to why I never told my parents. Trying to figure out how I became so brainwashed not to realize that it was abuse at the time. I've had graphic nightmares about Larry and about others trying to sexually abuse me. Paralyzed in my sleep, locked in that back room at Twistars, unable to scream while he puts his hands on me again. Other dreams of him molesting little babies as the guilt I have rises when I think of the girls even younger than myself at the time when this happened. Why didn't I see it? We were all so young. I used to have a sense of confidence in myself when going out with friends, but now I can't properly enjoy my time because I'm too aware of my surroundings, worried about older men in the room who all seem to be staring at me now. And I know they, and I feel, I know what they are thinking. And the anxiety gets so bad that I just have to leave. I have no trust in men of authority anymore. I no longer see my regular male doctor, as that has felt like a joke to me. And of course, I've switched to a woman. I sat in the waiting room of my chiropractor as my heart began to race as fast as it could, just as if I was running a marathon, unable to fathom the thought of another male doctor having to touch my body to help my back. It all felt too familiar. I've not been back to that chiropractor for my back since. I cannot run for exercise because of my sciatic nerve and arthritis in my back. The arthritis in my back flares up so bad, I find myself unable to walk for the next 5 days due to the pain. This pain connects all the way down to my knees, and my knees flare up during most physical activity. That must really have been some treatment and the best way to help my back. I can't even run, and I'm 22 years old. Do you know what that's like? I'm so angry and depressed over this, thinking that if I had a different doctor, then maybe I would be able to run today. Maybe I would have been treated properly so that when I sit down for 20 minutes, my legs don't go numb and tingly. And today, when I know I should see a doctor for my back, the anxiety of me meeting another doctor for all of this is just too much, and I put it off and I put it off. I'm stressed over my school schedule this last semester, and I'm doing what I can to make sure my professors are all females. That psychology class I took was only taught by a male, so I took it online. But only I knew these thoughts that I had been keeping up in my mind. I did not want to admit to myself nor to anyone else that this was actually changing my outlook on things. I do not want this to hold me back in life, but I'm going to let myself ease back into my life and into trust slowly. It is unfair what you have taken from all of us. You don't deserve a fair nor peaceful ending to your life. You deserve the maximum sentence available, and that is what I'm asking of you, Judge Aquilina, Judge Cunningham. And I have no doubt that you will do what is right. I remember how afraid I was when I had to testify in Eaton County, coming face to face with Nassar. Larry, you will spend the rest of your days in prison. We have won this first battle, but our war is not over. MSU knows what they have coming. You know that you've enabled and are accountable for ignoring the complaints from the past. And so I gladly say goodbye to President Luana Simon for your time. And I hope that, I'm sorry, and I gladly say goodbye to Luana Simon. Your time as president will be over. And shame on you, as well as for not listening to young women. And I hope you spend the rest of your days thinking about your 9 to 16-year-old self and how it would have felt to have been sexually assaulted and speak out only to be turned away. I actually plan on finishing my college career at MSU, and I better have a new president by the time I get there next fall. To USAG, I'm utterly saddened that Larry Nassar has caused the sport of gymnastics to be tied to the weight of sexual abuse and child molestation. I am more disgusted that you knew of this and failed to act when you should have. You failed to keep the sport of gymnastics safe and with the name it deserves. Gymnastics is a great sport, and there are absolutely incredible coaches out there. They know who they are. They will be the ones to save this sport, and I have no doubt that they will do that. To John Gettert, however, are not one of the great coaches I'm referring to. There is no excuse for you not knowing what is happening in your gym, except your excusable neglect and lack of leadership. I have told myself that for everything you have put me through, you will have what's coming to you. I do not believe you deserve to still have your gym. I do not understand how anyone could still want to train there, especially knowing that in that back room, in that back dungeon, hundreds of your athletes were being molested. This is your fault, and you are also accountable. My mama. To the Olympians, I thank you for coming forward, for being so brave, for knowing how much your names would be, knowing that your names would be in the media. I can't imagine the pressure you felt, knowing how much I felt as well. I need to say this to you all. Your legacy, Olympians, will not go down with the Larry Nassar case. You will not be remembered as the Olympians that were being molested by Larry Nassar, but as the gymnasts who were not only Olympians, but also heroes. He will not compromise your title that you worked so hard for, and we will not let him. Larry, I hope you are satisfied. You've ended up right where you've always liked to be, number one sports medicine doctor, number one gymnastics doctor in the country, and now, you are the world's number one child molesting pedophile that has ever been discovered. And now you will go where creatures like you belong. I have to thank the people in my life, my friends and close family, Without them, this would have been a hard battle to face alone. Most of all, my teammates, I'm thankful for our lifelong friendship. We will always be there for each other through the worst of times and through the best. You've all made me feel so understood, and that is the only thing that has truly got me through this. My boyfriend is in Australia studying abroad, and he told me that people are talking about this there. We are being heard not just here, but globally. Our message will change lives and make this a better future, ensuring that this disaster will not happen again and will not repeat itself.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Bailey, for writing such a thorough statement of how Nassar's acts have impacted you. As I said to Annie, though, please do not think that your story is diluted or any of the statements that the court will hear are diluted. Each story is unique and each is important, and I will take each of them individually into consideration in reaching a sentence. And I do apologize for my coffee, and I think like many of us in the community, I have something, and I certainly didn't want to delay the proceeding, so.
We appreciate that. Thank you, Judge.
Go ahead.
Your Honor, the next statement you will hear from is a charged victim in Ingham County who the last two weeks did not wish to give a statement but has changed her mind and asked if I would read her statement here. And I appreciate the court for allowing this to occur. She is not in court but has agreed to be publicly identified. In Ingham County, she was previously identified as victim F, and her name is Madison Bonifiglio. And it's my understanding she is somewhere watching the live stream. So I'm going to read her statement on her behalf. I went back and forth so many times about writing this statement. I personally felt like this man was not worth the time and energy. However, after hearing the things he wrote in his letter to Judge Aquilina, I had a few things I wanted to say. First, I am victim G. I came to the police in September of 2016 and testified against Larry in March of 2017. I graduated college in early May and got to start my adult life in the courtroom testifying against my childhood abuser. Clearly not the way I thought I would start the rest of my life. I cannot remember the first time I saw Larry as a doctor. I must have been around 8 years old, but when I look back on my gymnastics career, he was always a part of it. I would see Larry here and there for injuries throughout my childhood, which was very often because I was prone to injury. It was not until I started having severe back pain that I spent a lot of time with him. Before I figured out what was wrong with my back, I would see Larry once, even twice a week. I would spend at least an hour with him each visit, him doing a multitude of different quote-unquote procedures on me. These visits usually started with him checking my alignment, then massaging my back, along with the act we are here about today. He would ask me if I was, quote, loosening up, unquote, in which I always replied, no, it's not helping. I remember him getting upset that it was not helping and saying that this works for everyone else. Then he would move on to the other methods of treatments. This would continue almost every visit for my back from the age of 12 years old to the time I graduated high school at 18. Even though his treatment never helped my back, he continued to start every visit with this. After about 6 months of having severe back pain, Larry finally ordered me a bone scan. Sure enough, it came back with 8 fractures. I am not sure why it took so long to get a scan of my back when I visibly could not walk, standing straight up, and would black out in the middle of tumbling past because of the pain. I stopped seeing Larry for a few months after I got the results back because I was unable to practice and was told to just heal. When I began practicing again, I was very sore from not using these muscles for months. This required more massaging and more quote-unquote treatments. I saw Larry for years after this for my back, with him almost always penetrating me. When I turned 16, I finally got my period. When I had my first appointment with Larry during that part of the month, I was relieved that he could not perform it. I walked into his basement and immediately told him. To my surprise, that didn't matter. There was another way to perform the invasement treatment. I'm sure you can imagine the part of my body he touched, but if you would like, I will clarify. This was the most uncomfortable day of my life. I can still remember every detail of that appointment. I wanted to say stop, but I thought that would be rude of me. It sickens me that I was so obedient to any man like I was to Larry Nassar. Around the age of 16, I fractured my neck. All of my muscles were sore from trying to protect the injury, so Larry massaged my shoulders and thought it would help to penetrate me at the same time. This is when I started questioning the legitimacy of this penetration. How was this quote-unquote treatment correlated to my neck, I thought. But again, I dismissed my feeling in fear of upsetting Larry. As we all have heard, Larry had a way of making you feel special. He would let me come over to his house. I only lived a few minutes away. And on Sundays, he would turn on the fireplace for me so I was not cold. He would bring me souvenirs from Worlds or National Gymnastics meets. He would build up my self-confidence by telling me how kind, smart, and talented I was. He let us work for him by making videos of taping an ankle or a wrist or completing an exercise for injury prevention and pay us for our time. He would even count the hours he treated us as, quote, working hours. Now looking back, I realize all of this was not to make me feel special, but to give him an excuse to please himself. This was a major breakthrough for me. It took a very long time for me to fully immerse myself into seeing this man as a horrible human being. I lived years knowing this amazing person and being treated like I mattered. It was hard to flip that switch. The worst part of this whole journey was logically knowing Larry was a monster, but also feeling sorry for him. However, I realized the person I knew before is dead and never existed. He was wearing a mask to hide his true identity. When I first called Angela and Robin, I was completely confused on what I believed. I felt uncomfortable and used, but I did not know if I was just being dramatic. The only thing I was sure of that what happened to me might be important in figuring out who he was and his motives. I dove into the criminal case headfirst and committed to telling the truth and trying to remember every detail. I constantly had the feeling of being dirty and just wanted to wash it off. Wash off all the guilt I felt for betraying him and wash off the memories of him touching me before any boy or even myself. I was so young, I did not even know what my body was. He ruined that for me. He took away my innocence, and I will never get that back. The more I thought, the more I felt disgusted. When I testified against him in May of 2017, I sat in a room full of men in suits with him in my view. Trying not to look at him, I told invasive stories about what he did to me. He looked so different and showed no remorse. I thought, quote, maybe he's just trying to listen and take it all in. And then, after telling the story of when he touched me, telling me I was, quote, tight, and that it was okay because so was his wife, he chuckled like I was making this up. That is when I really started getting angry and not so confused. Judge Cunningham, there is one thing I would like you to consider when you decide this sentence. One of the reasons I decided to make a statement was to include all of the girls out there that did not come forward. I know at least 10 girls that I was teammates with in club gymnastics and in college and lived with that have been abused by Larry. Some of them decided it was best for them not to come forward, while others simply did not think it happened to them enough. On top of that, some were on his side because we saw the truth and felt stupid to come out after they supported him for so long. I do not know about you, but this really makes me sad that some of my best friends think that because they were only assaulted by Larry 5 to 10 times, that wasn't enough to matter. Personally, I think this really matters. 156 women have come forward about being abused. But there were probably the same amount, if not more, that have chosen not to. All of these girls and women deserve the closure with the maximum sentence possible. To Larry, your unfathomable actions have affected me in ways I never thought of in the beginning. Going to a doctor's appointment or physical therapist make me anxious. The smell of the scentless lotion makes me nauseous. Going to the gym to work out around men makes me uncomfortable. Going shopping and seeing a man with brown hair and glasses is petrifying. I think everyone around me is lying for their own agenda, and the closest people to me I second guess. I was so young, innocent, trusting, and saw the best in people. Now it takes me a very long time to feel comfortable with anyone. When I think back on gymnastics, I have no more good memories. It is all clouded by the horrible memories of you. You said to your letter to the Ingham County judge that, quote, what I did in the state cases was medical, not sexual. But because of the porn, I lost all credibility, end quote. No, because you did not use gloves. You groomed little girls. You got erections. You made every woman uncomfortable and completed this treatment absolutely incorrectly, touching parts of my body that have no other use than during sex. Then you said, quote, the media convinced them that it was wrong and bad. Wrong. In May of 2016, before any media had been exposed, Annie LaBrie had called me, and we talked for 3 hours about the treatment you gave us and how wrong it felt. We knew something was not right, but did not know where to turn. In addition, we thought you were a great doctor because we were 12 and you manipulated us. And we came back again and again and again because we had to. For the first time since I joined this case, I can finally say with full belief that you are a horrible human being and a waste of life. I truly hope you are being affected by all of these women's statements and feel at least a little bit of remorse for the lives you have altered, but I know that is not true. You are delusional and think this is all a media circus, but in fact, you are a serial sexual predator. To everyone else that created the atmosphere for this type of abuse to happen, it was the culture that all of us victims were in that created the perfect environment for Larry to flourish. I grew up doing gymnastics and was completely frightened to make a peep. This is not just the atmosphere at the gym I was part of, but everywhere. You are judged by your body, your looks, your cuteness factor, and then your skill. I was extremely self-conscious and still to this day struggle with feeling good enough because in my adolescence, I never was and it was impossible to be. To Michigan State University, I see you trying to make strides in the right direction, but it is also the culture that surrounds college sports that creates the environment that allows sexual abuse. I have seen firsthand being a college gymnast, the way athletes are protected for things normal students would get expelled for. These athletes and the athletic authorities live on a podium and feel like rules and laws don't really apply to them, that they are special and can get away with more than the average student. This is not just a problem at MSU, but at most universities. Men and women abused at a school that protect their student athletes for their horrible actions create an environment where victims do not feel safe enough to come forward. Until we change the culture where people with authority and talent do not get free passes, nothing will change no matter how many people resign. The answer to all of this abuse is the way we react when a woman or a man comes forward with a story. Larry Nassar had too much power in every institution he was part of. I would see Larry at the office when no one else was left in that 5 or 6 story building. I can only remember making an appointment with him maybe 5 times, but saw him there an uncountable amount. No one should have that amount of power and access to little girls ever. Thank you so much for letting my words be considered in this case and for listening to these women's stories. I hope change comes from this horrible abuse and that our statements will have an impact on mine and the rest of the nation's future children. I hope the world of gymnastics can get through the reputation Larry Nassar has created, and the world can see this sport as a beautiful, high-intensity, and strong sport again. Thank you, Judge Cunningham. Madison Bonifiglio.
Thank you, Madison, very much for your statement. It is a powerful statement. The court will definitely take it into consideration in determining the sentencing, and I think all of the statements are having an impact that go far beyond this courtroom. The next individual.
Your Honor, the next survivor to speak has requested that she be anonymous. I'm asking that the media turn off their cameras. I'll let you do that, actually.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we discussed prior to beginning the court proceedings, I ask that all recorders, all cameras be...
Your Honor, the next survivor you'll hear from is Tiffany Dutton, D-U-T-T-O-N. She is coming to the podium. Her husband is accompanying her here as her support person.
And what is his name?
Chad.
Thank you for being here, Chad.
First and foremost, I would like to thank the court, George Cunningham, for giving me the opportunity to come and address the defendant today. My name is Tiffany Dutton. Up until now, I have been identified as Jane A.O. Doe. On this day, I've decided to fully relinquish my anonymity as a symbol to myself that there's absolutely nothing I have to be ashamed or afraid of. You see, I am currently in the process of completing my master's degree in occupational therapy. And throughout the past year, I have feared that if I allowed myself to be identified publicly, there would be severe consequences for me within the medical and professional spectrum. This is but one of the many dilemmas that I have faced at the hands of Larry Nassar. Due to the bravery and courage of the many women who appeared in Ingham County to face our predator, I am no longer fearful. To all of them, I will be ever grateful. As I sat down to write my impact statement, I found myself struggling to find what it is I actually want to say to the defendant, besides the obvious. A million thoughts and emotions flooded my brain, racing around as I attempted to hone in on my target. It's a nearly impossible task to simply put words onto a piece of paper that accurately and completely describe everything that I feel and have felt since the very day that my path unfortunately crossed Mr. Nassar's. So I'll start with the basics. Mine is a similar narrative to many of the survivors. I was a competitive gymnast, and I started at a very young age. At the age of around 12, 13, I began having severe low back pain. Additionally, I had endured a fall unrelated to the sport that had left me with unbearable tailbone pain. In turn, I was referred to Mr. Nassar by my coaches at the age of 14. I knew who Larry was. We all did. He was the physician to the Olympians, the healer of gymnasts. Many of my teammates were either patients of his at the time or had been in the past. And it had been made very clear to me and to my mother how lucky I was to have the opportunity to be seen by him. I felt so privileged, so special, just knowing that I, of all people, get to have Larry Nassar as my physician. I will not discuss the details of what occurred during my appointments in East Lansing, as I'm sure everyone can take an educated guess by now. I will say this. It takes a monster to sexually assault a child, but it takes a monster backed by ego, experience, and power fueled by multiple institutions to sexually assault a child in front of their own mother. It was uncomfortable and terrifying, but who was I to question the treatment that was supposed to heal me? Something about it felt off, though at the time, I wouldn't have imagined that he was touching me for his own gratification. Shortly after my last appointment, I chose to leave the sport I loved. Somewhere between meeting him and leaving gymnastics, I began to experience overwhelming anxiety and depression. This only grew worse after I separated myself from the world of gymnastics. I had completely lost my identity. I was struggling to process and understand why I was feeling the way that I was. And I would be lying if I said I had never seriously contemplated taking my own life at that time. Fast forward to February of 2017. All the while, struggling with crippling anxiety and the panic attacks that come along with it. A preview for the 10 o'clock news appears across my television screen with a picture of Larry's face. The only words I heard from that preview were sexual assault allegations. Immediately I knew. I knew that what I had felt all those years ago was real. That he wasn't treating me for the back and tailbone pain that I suffer with to this day. But instead, he was running on his own sick and twisted agenda. This past year has been absolutely horrible. I still struggle with depression and anxiety. As a result, I have secluded myself from family and friends. I'm leery around male physicians and other healthcare providers. And I fear that somehow I too will unknowingly put my 2-year-old daughter into harm's way, just as my mother and many other mothers did. Anytime a male even so much as looks at her in a grocery store, I go in the opposite direction. Up until December, when I no longer had an option, I refused to place her in daycare. Because the opportunities for abuse are endless in that setting. Worst of all, I have had no choice but to compartmentalize all of it. Every feeling or thought I have had for a year, plus some, just to be able to make it through each and every passing day without completely losing it. All of the sadness, all of the fear, all of the anguish, all of the shame, and all of the anger. As a gift to myself, I'm leaving every last ounce of that here with you today. I'm taking back my life, the one you stole from me, my friends, and my family. Looking back on this day, I want my child to see that her mother had the courage to stand up for what was right and to face her abuser. I want my daughter, all of our daughters, and even your daughters, Larry, to see and know their worth. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tiffany, for being here today. I'm glad that you came, and your statement and everything that you went through will be considered. And Chad, thank you for being here as her support person and continue to provide support. Thank you very much.
The next survivor you will hear from has told us that she wishes to be publicly identified. She reached out sometime last week, right around the end of the last sentencing hearing, and I'm glad she's here today. This is Rebecca Bovine.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for allowing me to speak here today. It's taken me far too long to understand what happened and what is happening. Like so many others, I met Larry when I was 8 years old. At my first appointment, he checked my alignment. He had pulled my shorts on, so part of my butt showed. I felt so uncomfortable, but it turned into a joke with my mom and I as I got older. We continued to see Larry. We'd even go to the Twistars Invitationals just to see him because it would take so long to get in at MSU. It was at a Twistars invite that I met Brooke Lemon. We learned she worked at a Mason family practice a couple days a week. This was great news to us as I went to Mason High School. I started seeing Brooke for everything. She was my primary care physician and helped me with my injuries. It was easier to see her than Larry at the time. My senior year, Brooke was unavailable to be seen, so I went back to Larry. It was then that I experienced one of his treatments. My mom had signed a paper that I could be seen without her present. I was at MSU Sports Med. My appointment lasted hours. Several different treatments were done, checking alignment, acupuncture, and massage, just to list a few. The appointment ended with this treatment that we all know so well now. The appointment lasted so long that no one was left in the office. He had to show me out the back door. I didn't even check out, and then I thanked him. He made it seem like he was doing everything he could to make my pain go away by trying so many different treatments. I felt so uncomfortable, but brushed it off as normal, or I thought it was. I told my boyfriend at the time what had happened. I even called my mom and brought up my first appointment where I felt so uncomfortable and how this was even worse. But I couldn't bring myself to tell her why. How do you tell your mom something like that? Thinking back on the events, I'm thankful for Brooke. I wonder how many times she saved me from having this treatment done more than that one time. I find myself saying, I'm lucky. It only happened to me one time. There's all these other girls who had to endure this several times, hundreds even. I even tried to convince myself that it didn't really happen. I couldn't face my parents and tell them what happened. I told them in a text message, just as I told my husband. It wasn't talked about. It was an elephant in the room. I felt like a coward. The hardest part of all of this is that I'm not only a gymnast and a patient, but I was a mentee and an admirer. I went to MSU. I graduated from MSU. I worked underneath them in the athletic training program at MSU and at Holt High School. I then took the vacant position as the athletic trainer at Holt High School, where he served as the team physician. Not even a month into my time working at the high school, I received a call. It was the end of August 2016. I still remember it so clearly. I was working a soccer game. He called to tell me he was being investigated for sexual abuse and he wouldn't be at the school anytime soon. I couldn't believe it. I apologized, and then I pictured that one appointment at MSU Sports Med. This should have been a flag to me, but I couldn't face it. How is one supposed to face that? How am I supposed to continue doing my job like nothing happened? I work in a high school where so many other survivors have walked through those halls. A high school which holds hundreds of young girls. I would do anything for those girls, and I would do anything for my athletes, the athletes that I refer to as my kids. I didn't want to come forward because I felt ashamed, and I felt that admitting I was a victim of sexual assault, it would make me less of a role model to these kids. I thought they would think less of me, stop seeing me, trusting me, even confiding in me. I thought their parents wouldn't want me treating their kids. I'm still facing those doubts and insecurities. I'm even seeing a counselor so I can get through this. I'm sorting through not only the betrayal of Nassar, but understanding the role some of my own preceptors and mentors had in this time. My entire world has been flipped upside down. This doesn't just stem through my gymnastics career, but this is my professional career and my personal life. I can't even begin to explain how my parents and my husband are handling this. My mom blames herself. My dad couldn't set foot in the courtroom. We are nowhere near the end of dealing and coping with this. I feel no amount of time spent in prison will fix all he has done, but knowing he cannot harm another girl again brings some sort of comfort in all of this. I chose to stand up here today, not just for myself, but for all of the girls out there. To stand up here and tell my story, not with shame, not with guilt, but to be heard and know that my words matter. I'm here today to prove to these girls and my kids that their voice matters, their story is important, they are strong, and I encourage anyone who feels uncomfortable with something to speak up, to talk, to keep talking until someone takes action, because we all know talk is cheap. It's time to make a change. We are that change, all of us together. Thank you.
Rebecca, I'm so glad that you came forward today. And you are a role model. No one ever should say it only happened once, ever, right? We don't say that. Thank you very much for being here.
We're going to deviate a little bit from the schedule. I expect it won't be the first time. But But the next speaker you will hear from, the next survivor, is number 10 on your list. She will now be our number 8. Her name is Catherine Ebert, and I believe she goes by Kat.
Oh, okay.
And I do have,
good morning,
for the record, her photograph displayed on our slide.
Good morning.
Good morning. I would just like to say, first of all, thank you so much for letting me have my voice heard. I was a gymnast all my life. From ages 5 to 18, that was the only sport I participated in and the love of my life. As a child, I never had any major injuries besides a few aches and pains. However, around May of 2013, I suffered a bad bar accident that debilitated the movement of my right knee. Growing up in the area, I'd always heard of the great and famous Dr. Larry Nassar, the US Olympic team doctor, but I'd never had a reason to visit him until that moment in time. I remember feeling so grateful that he had time in his busy schedule for me. After all, he personally knew all of my gymnastics idols. I was 15 at the time, so my mom accompanied me to both visits with him. Walking into his exam room at MSU Sports Medicine, the walls were covered with autographed pictures of countless Olympians in multiple sports. I felt so incredibly lucky to be there. Larry, the first time I met you, you were kind and friendly and didn't mind me badgering you with questions about Jordan Weaver. You had a resident medical school student with you at my first appointment, and everything seemed fine. It wasn't until you took an ultrasound of my knee and your hands were just a little too far up my thigh that I first got a strange feeling. You quickly moved your hands and continued with the appointment, eventually sending me on my way, requesting a follow-up visit a few weeks later. The second and last appointment with you was unsettling. There are black holes in my memory that come back as nightmares or flashbacks, not wanting to believe they're true. At this appointment, you had no resident with you. It started out fine. It all seemed normal. And then you started to stretch me. Oh, I'm sorry. I believe the term you used was test my flexibility range. I'm very aware that this is a real test, as I've had it done many times since by a real doctor of osteopathic medicine, and your version was most certainly not correct. I was headed to practice immediately after the appointment, so I was wearing a leotard with sweatpants. You asked me to remove the sweatpants so you could inspect my knee, which made sense. This was an appointment for a knee injury. That's why I became slightly confused when you said you needed to stretch my hamstrings. But what did I know? You were the doctor. I thought it was strange that you got onto the table and leaned over me to do a split test, blocking my mom's view. I thought I imagined when your fingers brushed against the bottom seam of my leotard between my thighs. And then I stopped breathing when I felt a finger pry beneath the fabric and brush against me. In that exact moment, my mom got up and walked over to the side of the table, suddenly curious of your methods of treatment. You quickly removed your hand from my pubic area and climbed off the table to stand and tell us if I was getting better or not. I don't remember what you said. I couldn't hear you. I thought it must have been an accident. Maybe your hand slipped? I must have imagined it, just like I must have imagined the bulge in your pants as you walked around the exam table. I walked out of that exam room feeling confused, dirty, and broken. My gut felt nauseous, but my brain kept saying the same thing. He's a doctor. It's fine. You're supposed to trust doctors. They take an oath. He is a doctor. Stop overreacting. But I wasn't overreacting, was I? From that day on, I began to fall apart. I began to stay in my room alone whenever possible. I became angry and confused and frustrated with myself and everyone else, never really knowing why. When we called to schedule my next follow-up, you were completely booked for months, so I saw a new doctor, Dr. Brooke Lemon. Dr. Lemon was everything that you weren't. She would tell me where she was going to touch me before she did, always asking my permission. She strayed away from ever going near my private areas unless absolutely necessary. I always walked out of her office feeling better, but also worse. My body felt brand new, but my mind was numb. In the fall of 2013, I started to see a therapist for a depression that seemingly came out of nowhere. Hoping it would help, I saw a counselor weekly for months, but it only seemed to get worse. No matter how many therapists I saw, no one could seem to figure out where this self-hatred and anger was coming from. This thought haunted me for years. What was wrong with me? Why wasn't I normal? Why couldn't I just be happy?
It only seemed to get exponentially worse with time until eventually I hit rock bottom. In June of 2015, I was hospitalized for 8 days at a mental health institution. I was only 17. I'd been resisting medication for over a year now, trying to battle my demons without any help, but at this point, it was out of my hands. I was prescribed the strongest SSRI on the market, known for severe withdrawal symptoms and emotional equilibrium. Emotional equilibrium is the term I use to describe the numbness I experienced. I was no longer cutting myself, and I wasn't as angry or sad, but I was never happy or even remotely close. I was trapped in a purgatory of no emotions. Over the next year, I fell victim to two more accounts of sexual assault and was silenced from other people. I fell into a pit of despair that I couldn't escape. In the spring of 2016, Dr. Lemon informed me that my back was too injured to continue my gymnastics career, but allowed me to finish the season. I was heartbroken, but thankful for the short amount of time I had left to say goodbye to the sport I loved more than anything. The next day, the day before regionals, I informed my coaches, who proceeded to kick me off the team for my mental health and safety. Everything I loved was gone. Larry, your abuse took 3 years of my life away from me and my family. These past few weeks have been a nightmare of emotions and PTSD as I've come to terms with what you did. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't get out of bed. I skipped class. I skipped an exam. I lost all motivation as I was overwhelmed with the truth of your abuse. But that ends today. You are the most vile, disgusting creature I've ever met. Scum of the earth is too high of a title for you. I hope you realize that you will never have any power over anybody for the rest of your life. Because standing in this courtroom today and having my voice heard is a huge step in my personal healing process, and I know that my story will help to prevent this from ever happening again. Because it won't. It can't. MSU, I now turn my attention to you. As a student at Michigan State, I am completely heartbroken and betrayed by the school's administration. It's time to accept responsibility for your actions, or rather, lack thereof, and step down. I feel that the administration of my school is in the hands of uneducated sociopaths that feel no remorse and have absolutely no regard for the health and safety of the student body. I do not support them. Talk is cheap, but my tuition isn't, and I'm tired of your apologies. While I've been struggling through all of this emotional turmoil, you've been worried about basketball donors and how this university has, quote, many more things going on than this Nassar thing. I am deeply disappointed by the newly discovered hypocrisy and cowardice of the members that rule our institution. No more second chances, no resignation benefits, and no more lies. I would like to be included in any restitution settlement that is reached. However, that is not why I'm here today. Before I finish, I would like to point out how critically important it is to teach children signs of sexual assault, and that it is never okay for anyone to touch you in a way that makes you feel uncomfortable. After everything that my sister survivors and I have said, you will never be silenced for speaking up. Larry, have fun in prison. Now it's your turn to be abused. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You go by Kat?
Yes.
Kat, thank you very much for being here today. I read your statement last night and I found it very powerful, and I will give it strong consideration in determining the sentence, and I hope it helped you to be here today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I mean, really? It was on the screen.
Your Honor, the next speaker, we'll kind of get back on our list, is your number nine. I'm told that she does now wish to be publicly identified, but before we do that, I believe she may be a minor. I'd ask that her father, who's in the court with her.
Okay. I think I'm not sure I have the list that she's working on. What, could you, pardon me? Yeah, but I don't show that's a minor. Why don't
I think we don't have that as a minor on the there's two lists, right?
Okay.
This is very fluid, unfortunately.
I understand. Why don't we first identify the parents?
Yes. I know it's Matt and is it
Krista?
I'm sorry. Krista Covey, Covey. Covey.
Okay. And are you the mother is
yes.
Krista, you said?
Krista, Your Honor.
And you are, sir?
Matthew.
Matthew Covey, that's Covey?
That's correct.
All right. Now, you have a daughter that is a minor, correct?
That is correct.
And she was a victim of the criminal actions of Larry Nassar?
The animal did, yes.
And as her guardian and as her parents, are you agreeing that it is okay for her to be identified and for her to make a statement?
Yes, we are.
Okay. And her name is Maya, correct?
Yes.
Maya, would you like to make a statement?
Yes, please.
Okay. Whenever you feel comfortable, you go ahead and start, okay?
Judge, I do have a photograph at the family center. I wanted to confirm.
Okay.
I know we had spoke earlier.
Yep.
We were not going to disseminate that, but
absolutely. We'll just take a minute. And
no, they've changed their mind.
Right, I'm saying.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
We'll just take a minute and let you put that up. While we're doing that, Maya, I know that this. I can't imagine. Actually, this is overwhelming. All of the individuals, and all of the cameras, but we do have to record everything that said, and so to the best of your ability, if you can. Talk to me. Just talk loud enough so you can let me move over, okay?
Okay.
You just talk to me and have a conversation with me, okay?
Okay. This is very short, but I would just like to say something to Larry. Larry, I was told to trust you by everyone, my parents, my coaches, and even my teammates. You promised you're going to help me, so I trust you, even though you knew what you were doing was wrong. For the past 2 years, I haven't been able to trust anyone or open up to anyone because I felt like what you did to me was my fault, and I thought that nobody would believe me. You were someone that I looked up to because I was told you were going to heal me. Instead, you stole my innocence and emotionally scarred me. I know that I'm going to move on and be okay from this, but this is something that will always be there, and I will never forgive you for this. I'm thankful for the brave survivors for giving me the courage to come forward and face my nightmare and the monster for the last time. It is time for change, and my voice matters.
Your voice does matter. Your voice matters very much. Thank you for having the courage to be here today. Thank you to your mom and dad. And your statement will be taken into consideration at sentencing, I promise you. Thank you very much for being here.
Okay, Your Honor, next we have on your list number 46. And this survivor is asked to remain anonymous. We are identifying her from the Master Excel list as number 86. She has asked us to read a statement on her behalf. And that statement will be read by our victim advocate, Rebecca Snyder.
All right, so we will not be revealing the name of the individual, correct?
Correct. It is my understanding we can do the live stream now. Is that that's
yes.
Our
she says
right.
Media is okay, but no name.
All right, so you're all okay because we will not, the individual will not be talking in person and they will not be revealing the name. I'll have the statement for me to take into consideration with all the other statements for sentencing. Is that right, Rebecca?
Yes, and she is in the courtroom as well.
Okay.
Ready?
Go ahead.
I was a gymnast from the age of 4. I loved gymnastics, and I loved the feeling of flying through the air. I quickly became very good and needed to move gyms a few times to find coaches that could coach me to meet the goals that I had. I was 10 years old when I moved to Michigan and went to Twistars. I had an injury with my knee when I arrived. That was when I first met Dr. Nassar.
At first, he was really nice and helped my knee. As the verbal and emotional abuse began with my coach, John Getter, Larry offered me some hope that I could motivate and help make my coach like me better. My days were hard, and I was always getting screamed at, ridiculed in front of everybody at the gym, and kicked out of practice. I was terrified to go each day and would puke and get hives every day on my way to practice. Writing this now makes me realize how much I must have loved the sport to put up with this abuse each day. I had a small injury at school one day that got worse after a hard fall at practice. My entire leg swelled up like a softball. I went to see Dr. Nassar that evening in the back room at Twistars. My mom came with me to this. As Larry lied me down in the massage table while I had on my leotard, he tried to show my mom how to help my leg at home. My mom is a trained therapist and knows this technique well. He then penetrated my anus with his thumb and began to manipulate my muscles, stating that it would help my leg. I was immediately scared and embarrassed as he dug around inside of me. He made me upset and I tried hard to wiggle away, but he aggressively held me down. My mom was surprised and told him that she had never seen it done like that before and had been trained for years to do this too. Dr. Larry was nervous with my mom. I was upset, and when we left, my mom told me that that had made her upset too. I did not have Dr. Nassar work on my leg after that because I lied and said it was better so that I did not have to go back again. I did see him for my elbow injury. After a while, he referred me to a different doctor for my elbow at Michigan State University. The doctor was his friend, and he said he was good. The other doctor just told me to rest my arm, and this happened for a year. After a while, my mom said we needed a second opinion because my arm was still bad. We had to go to the University of Michigan. My doctor there told me my arm was in very bad shape and needed surgery right away or I would not be in sports anymore. My new doctor told my mom that I was about a month away from losing my elbow for sports and not being in sports with my arm anymore at all. I was very sad and upset because sports are my whole life. I feel the treatment that I got at Twistars with Dr. Larry Nassar and his friend at MSU causes me pain and changed me forever. I am not the same anymore. I don't trust people. I have a hard time making friends, and I cannot cry. I have panic attacks, and I can't go anywhere near a gymnastics gym. I have been trained to not show emotion and to not smile or have fun. It is sad because it is hard for me, and I am 13 now. I was 10 and 11 years old when this happened to me, and I still remember it like it happened, even though I am a lot older now. Number 86.
Thank you for reading the statement. And to the individual that wrote the statement, I don't really even want to look out in the galley because I don't want to inadvertently do anything to reveal the identity. Thank you very much for making the statement. The court appreciates it. I'm glad that you did not lose the loss of your elbow. And the court will take your statement into consideration at sentencing. Thank you very much.
Judge, may we approach for just about?
You may. Take by the clock on the wall in the courtroom, it says that it is 9 minutes to 12. We'll be back at approximately 10 minutes, so let's say 5 after 12, and then we'll go until 1 o'clock as discussed.
All rise.
to continue? We are back on the record, and people of the state of Michigan versus Larry Nassar, file 17217FC. Are we ready to continue?
We are, Your Honor. Your Honor, the next survivor you'll hear from has somewhat of a unique request. So she is going to be speaking to you anonymously, but her mother has asked to address the court when she's finished, and her mother is comfortable, as is the daughter, with being publicly identified. So the victim wishes to remain anonymous. The mother wishes to say a few words publicly, if that's okay with the court.
Well, under the Crime Victims' Rights Act, each victim or their representative has the right to address the court at sentencing. Again, the purpose of that is to give the court information regarding the impact of the defendant's criminal action so I can consider it at sentencing. If the victim's mother is going to be brief, I certainly do not want to tell her she cannot speak. However, since the victim is speaking, I would ask that it stay under 5 minutes. If she would like to address the court, then that would be fine with me.
Thank you, Your Honor. With that, the next speaker will be anonymous. So I would ask that the live feed be turned off, and the recording and the photographs.
Okay. Ms. Preston.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today, Your Honor. Thank you for the rock. I chose truth. And truth, it is what I will share. I am the mother of a Larry Nassar victim. I have played the guardian role as chaperone, carpool mom, giver of healthy snacks, sender of messages, and supporter of many of the young women I have watched on TV over the course of the last 2 weeks. My name is Amy Preston. My daughter was a teammate of many of the girls speaking at this sentencing and the last sentencing. I have known these girls since they were just that, girls. I am proud to see how poised, eloquent, and well-spoken they are. They are telling their truth. John Gettert behaved as brutally as they say, and Larry was as kind as they speak. A very toxic and lethal combination, as it turns out. My daughter was a level 10 gymnast since grade school, had similar injuries, and so was treated at Twistar's back room, Larry's basement, Michigan State's facility, his office, and our home. And I, like other parents, sat in the room during visits, so appreciative and humbled that the great Dr. Larry was giving my daughter his undivided attention and making her feel better in every way she needed, mind, body, and soul. Once, when Larry came to our home in Brighton, Michigan to work on her, he brought her waffles with fresh berries and Cool Whip. Larry was part of the family. He gave us gifts from past Olympics and from Michigan State. He gave her a special necklace with the Lord's Prayer on it for confirmation. When I asked him why he was so driven to be helpful, he said he always inspired to be the modern day Norman Rockwell. So I would find Norman Rockwell books and antique trinkets to give him as a thank you. McDonald's gift cards for his own children's special treats, as he was a great dad and always helping with homework and dinner time, etc. My father is the best man I know. Kind, loving, trustworthy, hardworking. My father gave of himself in service to others his entire life. Larry fell into that same category of trust and respect for me. My father's heart sank when he learned what Dr. Larry had been doing. Not Larry, not the good cop, not the healer, the advisor, the saint we all loved and adored. When my daughter abruptly wanted to quit gymnastics as she was entertaining which full ride scholarship she wanted to attend, we couldn't believe it. The icing on the cake was just around the corner. So for 3 months, we contemplated this decision with her. One night, a week before regionals, John kicked her out of the gym for not making her routines and having a tired, bad attitude. She called me, said it was her last practice ever, no more. I told her to call Larry and talk to him about the decision. If he agreed that she should be done, then so be it. He then called me and asked if he could drive her home on a Thursday night from East Lansing to Brighton. I thought this to be an exorbitant measure, but that was how he was. He cared deeply for their well-being. I said, sure, okay, thank you. She came home, he called me, she was done. Still to this day, I do not know what was said. Still to this day, I regret that night. I regret the trust I gave him, the blind adoration. When the story broke, it made me nauseous to think of either extreme. One, that he did what people were saying he did, or the other, that he didn't and he was being falsely accused. My daughter wanted nothing to do with the whole topic. She was angry, she rebelled, and she shut me out. She was almost 17. And she started skipping school and making very, very bad decisions. As the Nassar story continued to unfold, last summer, she started to find some stable ground, and she was of the age of 18. Then, September of 2017, my daughter became suicidal. When she finally acknowledged she was being abused like the rest, I found out that she had already had one failed suicide attempt and was headed for a second. I got her hospitalized. I connected her with a sexual assault counselor. I gently talked to her about coming forth and speaking at the sentencing last week. She wasn't ready. She wasn't as far along in her healing as some of the others and her teammates. I wasn't going to force her. Now at the age of 19, leading male role models in her life, including her coach and her team doctor, have turned out to be very sick individuals. It breaks my heart. I too am trying to process my guilt, my misguided trust, and my part in the story. But we listened to the girls speak their truths. We listened to the closing arguments on both sides and the judge's sentencing. Words can't describe how empowering that was. I will never be the same. The world heard the girls and the court. I pulled out what I needed to know and I placed it on the table to look at. I was able to distinguish between fact and fiction, right and wrong. I loved the 8 takeaways, Ms. Povilaitis. I can now take a deep breath and move forward. Thank you for doing your part. And today I am doing mine. May I address the dependent? Larry, more than any other emotion, I am sad beyond despair. You not only stole the childhoods of so many, you took the trust we as parents gave you and you abused it. It can never be restored. It is destroyed beyond recognition. Thank God. Everything that you stood for, healing, helping, guiding, nurturing, educating, and teaching have been manipulated, mutilated beyond recognition. The modern day Norman Rockwell has been buried. The seeds of hope, respect, responsibility, and accountability have been planted on the grave. Just like the lotus petal that is on my daughter's arm, out of the smelly, foul muck of life, a beautiful, vibrant flower is taking shape to the young women our judicial system is supporting and the court system is empowering. John, you tried to teach our girls to be quiet and obey, and we now stand before them and say, speak. Move forward in your lives with grace and integrity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Preston, for being here today. As I said, under the Crime Victim Rights Act, the victim or a representative has the right to make a statement, and that is the agreement that was reached between the Attorney General and the defendant. You are the only one today that has asked, but I want to say that you will be the only one that will be allowed to speak because I did say that I would abide by the terms of the plea agreement. Having said that, I think many parents, friends, and guardians, although not legally classified as a victim in this case, have suffered and have gone through this process, feeling all of the emotions that you have so clearly articulated of what the parents have gone through. And so I do appreciate your being here to make that statement. And I think that what you said today, you say on behalf of all of the parents and family members and close friends that have experienced this. So thank you very much for being here.
I do, and thank you.
the next individual to speak, Ms. Provolitis?
Your Honor, it's my understanding the next folks you will hear from are parents who are speaking on behalf of their child.
No, that's absolutely allowed.
Your Honor, the survivor, her name is Chandler Lynn. Okay, she is in college and cannot be here. I believe her parents and her coach are here, and her mother will speak on her behalf. Is this the correct spelling?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we're going to need that so that Ms. Cook has it for the record.
So for the record, Chandler is C-H-A-N-D-L-E-R, last of L-Y-N-N. And would you mind spelling and stating your name too, please?
Justine, J-U-S-T-I-N-E-L-Y-N-N.
And you are Chandler's father?
I'm not. I'm Justine's boyfriend, John Walker.
Okay. And then the coach?
Shannon Hunt.
Shannon?
Hunt, H-U-N-T.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Justine, go ahead.
Larry, today is the day I'm speaking up and deciding to tell my story. I have thought over and over how hard it would be to put this all into words, because I'm still in denial about it, and because I never in a million years thought I would have to write something like this, especially about you. You were my hero. You were the reason I was still able to compete in the sport I loved. Getting injured is such a frustrating thing, but you always had a way out, a loophole, or a treatment that would make it okay for me to keep competing. You were different from every other doctor I saw. You wouldn't bash the sport of gymnastics and try and convince me it would be best for my body if I just took up another sport. You understood gymnastics, you understood all my goals, and knew being sidelined wouldn't help me achieve them. You were the hope in the face of tragedy. I felt privileged to see you, knowing you were not only an amazing doctor, but the doctor for many of the gymnasts I looked up to. I specifically remember the first appointment I had with you at Michigan State University, following the nurse and getting seated in one of your examination rooms and seeing that framed medal on your wall signed by the members of the women's gymnastics team from the 2012 London Olympics, thanking you for all you've done. I was so excited for you to help me like you helped them. And like I said above, I felt so privileged and thankful I got the opportunity to be seen by the amazing Larry Nassar. Since 2013, up until the beginning of your trial last week, you were the doctor that saved me. You were the reason I am still in this sport, the reason I made it to competing in collegiate gymnastics. Everything I ever accomplished in gymnastics was all because of you. You helped me through my injuries and made it possible for me to compete. Knowing how highly I thought of you, you can imagine my disappointment and shame and my complete and utter sadness as now I have to write this and admit that I was too a victim of yours. For a while I hated myself for not realizing it sooner, for not believing anything I saw in the media and for sticking up for you as long as I did. Because how could a person my mother and myself both trusted so deeply turn out to be such a manipulative monster? Being in denial about what you did to me was a lot easier than having to admit it. I thought to myself when I felt like speaking up, why deal with the pain when I could just ignore it? I am saddened that that's probably what I would have done for the rest of my life if it weren't for Judge Rosemarie Aquilina and her allowing all the survivors of your abuse to share their stories. Watching and listening to every woman give their statement and realizing that they were all so painfully similar to the things I experienced getting treated by you made it almost impossible not to speak up. I didn't want to have to believe that things I thought you were doing to help me were actually things you were doing to pleasure yourself. Like when you would see me after hours at MSU to treat me because I had a meet coming up or a Region 5 training camp and you had no available appointments during the day, so you suggested I come after close. Back then I thought you were so nice for taking the time out of your night to help me because you cared about me. But now I realize that it was just you wanting to pleasure yourself at my expense. Or when you put your ungloved fingers inside me in the same room with my mother without no warning or explanation as to how that would help me heal me. And I still never said a thing, no matter how uncomfortable it made me, because I told myself you were just treating my back. You were just helping me. I also told myself that if my mom thought it was weird, she would have said something about it. But what I didn't realize was that you always positioned yourself and me in a way she couldn't see what was happening. Or when I thought you were a genius for using acupuncture to help me with my back, because no doctor ever tried that before on me, then you deciding that practicing and competing with stick-on acupuncture needles would help me immensely, I was so excited to feel better, and I was so excited not to hurt. I admired you for going out of your way to think of things that would help me. But now I realize that 12 needles on my stomach, more than half of them being placed below the waistband of my pants, resulting in me having to pull my pants down on the examination table for you to place them and treat me, wasn't for my benefit, it was for yours. I see a doctor up at school now, and when I see her, the treatment she does for acupuncture, she places the needles in the location where I am experiencing the pain, on my back. It is very clear to me now the needles you placed on me so far from the place that was actually hurting me, a place where I so conveniently had to pull my pants down, was just you pleasuring yourself, again at my expense. This made me think about all the times you would treat me with cupping or you would apply KT tape to my back. It always seemed to result in me having to pull my pants down so you could place it correctly. I hate that I trusted you so deeply. I hate that I never questioned your treatments or your actions while performing the treatments, no matter how strange they seemed. I thought you were closing your eyes while treating me to pleasure yourself because you said you were just thinking really hard, and I believed you. I hate how you fooled me and brainwashed me into thinking of you as nothing other than amazing doctor. I feel ashamed that I believed for so long that I was lucky to be a patient of yours and thought of you as my friend, when really all along you were my abuser. The last time I saw you in August of 2016 before I left for college, and shortly after that, September 1st, I believe, is when all the accusations about you began. My mother and I contacted you personally via Facebook or by text, asking what to do because the doctor and trainers at my school needed a note from you assuring them that you had cleared me for my back injuries and I was okay to practice. When you got back with us, you told us how to get my medical records from MSU, and on top of that, you said everything going on with the accusations was just a misunderstanding and that you had a bunch of gymnasts, coaches, and other doctors in your corner ready to defend you, and you apologized to us for the inconvenience. And we again so naively believed you. Around the same time, my club coach called me one night up at school right before everything became public, telling me that you were under investigation because she wanted to be the first to tell me before I heard it on the news. And she asked me if anything happened to me. And without even knowing at the time that I was lying to her and myself, I told her no, and that you were a good doctor because, like I said earlier, you saved me. You were the reason my body made it to this point and the reason I got the opportunity to compete at a collegiate level. So I owed everything to you. Who was I to accuse you of anything? I was lucky to have even been treated by you. I now realize that all this time, up until your trial last week, I refused to believe there were people as evil as you in the world. I refused to accept that the things you did to me were wrong. I so badly wanted to believe you actually wanted to help me and so many of the other people you treated, when you really are just a sick, pathological liar to yourself and everyone around you. You're a manipulator and a monster and a criminal that abused his medical license in the worst possible way. You deserve every bit of the sentence you already got. I feel sick to my stomach thinking that since 2013, I thought that you saved me. You, Larry, did not save me. You ruined me. You hurt me and betrayed me more than I ever thought was possible. What saved me was the 150 plus women that decided to face you in court and tell their stories to the world. Without them, I would not be speaking up and for the first time admitting to my family and friends, and most importantly myself, that I too was sexually abused by you. I wish I had the courage that they did to speak up sooner and the strength they did to address you face to face in court. But I didn't have it in me to do that. So I watched all the impact statements and saw all of them to be set free from your chains by admitting what happened to them. Instead of being ashamed of it, Larry, I wish every day that I had the courage to speak up sooner, but all that matters is now, is that I have now, and I'm not scared or ashamed anymore. By admitting this, I can finally begin to heal and move forward like all the other survivors of your abuse. I know this wasn't my fault. I know that I am not alone. I know that I have many people who love me and will support me in dealing with this. And most importantly, I know that you will never hurt me again. I'm leaving you behind. I'm setting myself free by using my voice. I am not what has happened to me. I am what I choose to become, which is not a victim of yours, but a survivor.
Thank you very much for reading Chandler's statement. Please let her know that I greatly appreciate it and that it doesn't matter when she chose to speak. It's just important for her and others that she spoke. I know this was very difficult for you. I could tell that it was. So I hope this process helps your whole family. And John and Shannon, thank you also for being here. Thank you very much.
Survivor you'll hear from is a minor. Her parents will be accompanying her to the podium, and it's my understanding they do wish to be publicly identified, but will follow the process.
Is that 211 or 225? Or you'll just wait and tell me now. Never mind.
That's it's fine. Number 54 on your list. It's 217 on the Excel list.
Okay.
And the 54 on the order list.
Okay. So is this Mr., is it Blair?
Yes.
B-L-A-Y-E-R?
Correct.
What's your first name, sir?
Steve.
And ma'am, your name?
Rhonda.
R-H-O-N-D-A?
R-O.
R-O, no H. Also Blair, correct? And you are the parents of Erin?
Yes.
And as her parents, you are agreeing that it is okay for her as a minor to identify herself and make a statement to the court?
Yes.
I appreciate you being here today. Erin, whenever you're ready.
First, I would like to provide some background information. In fifth grade, at the tender age of 11, just a month after my birthday, I came home from school with excruciating pain in my back and spasms so bad you could see the movement on me. After seeing my primary care doctor, Dr. Mark Israel, I was sent straight to the hospital for tests with nothing but the clothes on my back. After a week on level 7 of the PEDS floor at Sparrow Hospital, I was released with no reason for my pain and a couple of pain medication pills. From that point on, I began going to intense physical therapy 3 to 4 times a week with many other doctor's appointments in between. Slowly but surely, I began to get my mobility back and was fortunate enough to start seeing Dr. Covan at Michigan State Sports Medicine. I saw him for a while with the hopes of finding a cure to my mysterious back pain quickly. Unfortunately, that was nowhere near in sight. After around a year, due to Dr. Covan's limited ability in the winter from being the team doctor for Michigan State men's basketball and the need for another perspective, Dr. Covan suggested another doctor to help fill my needs. I was referred to the decorated Dr. Larry Nassar. From that point on, the long journey began. Regular visits were scheduled. Every 3 weeks or whenever I needed, I saw Larry Nassar to work per usual. These appointments consisted of the general adjustments and the new attempts to help me out, which only served as temporary help. Now I'd like to address the defendant. Before I get started, I would like to say this to you, Larry. I am not here for you or your pain. I am here strictly to tell my feelings and my story. For all the girls that have already spoke, for all those who will, and all those who are like I was, struggling with their new reality of being a victim. When I say here, what I say here will not change your future right now, but will provide you with another perspective to think about. I never thought I would be up here today. When I first heard the news that there was an ongoing investigation, I had two thoughts. One, these women are doing this for attention. And two,
because that is not the person I know and trust. I was heartbroken and almost 15-year-old girl. I was a heartbroken, almost 15-year-old girl sitting on a couch, surrounded by my parents, being asked unimaginable questions about my well-being. I found out when I was supposed to have an emergency appointment the next day, but was very surprised to hear that you were on leave for an unknown amount of time. Almost 15, I had my learner's permit, was in my freshman year of high school, and my biggest worry was whether I was going to get asked to the school dance or not. Almost 15, and little did I know that the next year would be the hardest of my life so far. As I sat on the couch and thought about what was going to happen, I did try to stay optimistic. With no thought at all, I denied ever feeling uncomfortable, despite what my heart was telling me to say. I did everything in my power to protect you. I truly believed that denying the truth would make the problem go away. Well, fast forward less than a year later, and here I am, standing in front of you, doing many things I hate. I am seeing you, putting my whole truth out for everyone to hear, and public speaking, which does not make me happy. So I hope you are actually ready to listen, Larry. Helpless, like I was, to my story that is different than any other girl that has spoke or any other that will speak. I am here to move on and leave you in my past. But first, I must do my part and do my best to help clean up the mess you have made. I may not ever be able to do a lot. I may not be able to do a lot, but I sure as hell know I am doing far more good than you will ever be remembered for. I know I am just a voice, but lucky for me, I am now part of an army. The army of survivors. I'll give it to you though. You did somehow manage to bring together and connect over 160 women and girls from all different backgrounds, which is impressive and extremely unfortunate for you, because now we are all here and ready to make sure you never see outside of prison walls again. So I hope you are ready, because you deserve so much more than your sentence and so much less in life. Unlike many of the women and girls that have been talking, I am not a gymnast or a dancer, rather a soccer player. The special case for you. Age 12 in the case that no one can crack that excited you. But did it excite you because of the medicine or because of the young impressionable age? I came to you as a sad, hurt, and helpless little girl with parents that were feeling the same way. I was tired of all the people I had to see, and you jumped on that opportunity. From the first appointment I saw you, you welcomed me, made me feel special, comfortable, and not like a lost cause. With all the stories you told me from the Olympics, I began to warm up to you and trust you. Trust you to try out all the new treatments. Then came the acupuncture, cupping, more physical therapy, and many other future solutions. You even gave me a number to call for emergency visits when the already scheduled ones weren't enough. When the pain was unbearable, you stayed late, even after all the others had left, just to help me. I guessed after seeing so many doctors and trying so many new things, I was open to anything and everything you suggested. You knew this and used up every ounce of my innocence, not only abusing me, but the oath you took when becoming a doctor, to respect the privacy of your patients and not play God. Well, Larry, there's only one God, and he sure is not you. So it's time to stop playing it. You manipulated my back, and with it my mind, my 12 to near 15-year-old mind, not only abusing your power, but all the other girls and me. You abused me when you thought it was okay to treat me, when you thought it was okay to not explain a process, use no gloves, stick your fingers into my vagina, then proceed to rub the surrounding areas and my body, and then continue on to the next form of treatment without washing your hands, not batting an eye, like nothing had ever happened. I thought a back rub was fine at first, but that was simply what you wanted, to test the waters. This was just like many times before, and I did not and would not ever at the time say a thing, because I finally found someone that knew my back and knew some ways to help me feel a little better. And why get rid of a perfectly nice, kind, and caring doctor because I felt a little uncomfortable? I do wonder what else you did that I never noticed or failed to mention, especially in those long appointments that ran far over 2 hours. These appointments after a long day when I was supposed to just lay on the table resting and would eventually fall asleep from being tired, only to wake back up to your voice 15 to 20 minutes later. If you could pull off your little tricks while I was awake, there's no doubt in my mind that you could have done it when I was asleep. Now, contrary to what many people seem to have popular opinions on, I don't blame my parents for anything. They never saw what you did. They, like me, were blinded to the truth. My parents did an amazing job taking me place to place, spending thousands and thousands of dollars for treatments, and attending every appointment with me. They respected my privacy, and in the two-hour appointments, read a book to pass the time. And that is why it was not always easy to see what you were doing. Before I go any further, I want to say to all the other parents out there that feel like they are helpless, even if they were in the room, every case is special, of course, but I want you to know it is okay to feel lost and betrayed. It is a process not just for the victims, but those around them. What you did, Larry, was hurt families. You made everyone question trust and parenting abilities, which is something families should never have to do. You didn't just affect the victims, but the families as well with your cunning manipulation. Along the way, you also managed to destroy your family. Your poor, sweet family that is stuck with your name lingering around them. Your ex-wife that was one of my other doctors that I trust so much and is such an amazing person, and you don't deserve. Her or your kids. Your kids that will no longer have a father figure and future grandkids. They'll ask where their grandpa is, but be told a lie to hide the fact that he was and is a monster who lived at the expense of the pain of others. With the questioning of trust from us to you and my family came the questioning of trust everywhere else. Larry, while you are rotting away in jail, your crimes will still be in effect as we try to erase every aspect of you from our lives. I used to be excited to meet new people, whether it was doctors trying to help or just meeting new people in general. And now, quite frankly, I'm scared. Now I have a large amount of anxiety when I meet a new doctor, when I'm meeting new teachers, sitting next to a new person in class, or when I am just walking alone and a person is behind me that I do not know. The worst part is the fact I cannot trust some of the people that I do already know. There are great people that I've been blessed to meet, and it is truly a shame and embarrassing that I don't see you as one of those people anymore. You've destroyed the way I look at male role models in my life and destroyed any new relationship with people I may have in the near future. So many questions flow through my mind when I think about what happened and you. Did you know that one day you would be knocked off of your pedestal? Did you really need to touch one more girl until one more wasn't enough? Was it so hard to reach out and ask for help? A large amount of your survivors were denied the help they needed and deserved multiple times, and yet still found the courage to stand up. It is hard to break an addiction, but the fact that it was known and took you 20 years to admit absolutely disgusts me. Finally, was it worth the 175 years? Because while your face may say no today, something inside me says that the sick, twisted part of you thinks it was. You got so caught up that nothing else mattered, not the treatment, the job, and not the family, and that is on you. Now, just in case what I said about the pain you caused was not enough, here's a little bit of a description of what I personally have gone through. When I came to terms with what happened, I did try to tell someone who I thought of as a close friend that I felt uncomfortable at times. I was told it was all in my head, and boy, was I quick to believe that. I believed it so much despite the fact that I did not feel right. Despite the fact that when your face was on the television or your name on the radio and my parents rushed to turn it off, I was in horrible pain. Despite the fact that kids would yell, "Free Larry Nassar," at school, and I would fake sick to go home and just get away from the pain. More recently, as your name was going around and around more and more, I came to terms with the fact that I was going to have to say something. I got very sick for unexplainable reasons. I could not eat or sleep and missed 2 weeks' worth of school days. Soon, the anxiety that I had before hit harder than ever, and then came the depression. I would and still sometimes am up until 3 a.m., freaking out and crying, wondering what is wrong with me, absolutely hating myself because of you. I would even try to call more than 5 people multiple times until I realized no one would answer and I was alone and isolated. Around this time, my grades also got low from missing school, and I had to change into easier classes because the work and general stress was just too much. I would go home and lay down, not sleeping, but thinking about where I went wrong. 2 months before, I was thriving at school and in all my classes, not just going through the motions. You did this to me, Larry. I shut myself out and after a while was not one bit like my regular fun, energetic self. And quite frankly, if it weren't for a close friend encouraging me to speak, the other girls deciding to speak, and being done with all the crap you put me through, I don't know what would have happened. If it weren't for the dreadful night I told my mom on a couch, drawing on my leg, because looking at her in the eyes, showing all of my pain was too much at 2 a.m., I do not know what would have happened. If it weren't for my family that offered a strong support system and forming plans A to Z on what to do, I don't know what would have happened. I never would hurt myself because of you. Because nothing, I can say, I would never hurt myself because of you, though. Because nothing is worth that, and you don't deserve to be on another person's mind causing pain. I still can't eat or sleep, and the only thing getting me through most weeks is the fact that I get to play a sport I love with wonderful coaches, teammates, and altogether athletes. Out of all the things you ruined for me, sports is definitely not one of them, so I just wanted to make sure that you made a special note of that. I do have to say, though, walking into a room that was once yours at Michigan State Sports Medicine, that was once decorated with all of your thank you letters and achievements, stings a little. But each time, it stings less and less. There's nothing that could have ever prepared me for what me and all the women have endured, and probably won't be for a long time, especially in the area of abuse that is neglected in the teen education and pushed aside in the big world. I wish I could have reached out and had someone tell me everything was going to be okay, or spoke up quicker. But that is all a product of your work. I was speechless and helpless, and now you are. Now I have a few not-so-kind words towards others that were responsible in this case. Since I am not a gymnast and cannot fully grasp or relate the problems going on in the obviously corrupt world of U.S. gymnastics, I will leave that to the other women that can speak for us all and have done a great job so far. What I can speak about is Michigan State University. My family has a deep love for MSU. My father is an alum, and we have been involved in many other functions through the college. Normally pleased and with nothing but praise for the university, I am going against everything I thought today. I've never been more disgusted or angry towards the people that let this go on. Larry Nassar was first accused in 1994, and by 1997 was working for MSU. One accusation went by and nothing was done but neglected and pushed aside. By 1998, there were even more, and one was even a six-year-old. Yet, once again, nothing was done. I hope you know what you have done by not investigating this man so much earlier. If you had, there would have been so many girls saved from the pain. I was not born until 2001. That gave 7 years for change, of which I should have been born to a world where he was irrelevant, and there was more great doctors working at sports medicine like Dr. Covan. After 7 years went by, there was still 12 more years until I would know his name. Yet I was unaware of any problem that would affect me long term, just like everyone else seeking help. As to the little fund you set up to help all the victims, you are doing nothing but attempting to cover your tracks with money. In this case, nothing, not even the so-called generous $10 million makes a difference. The real difference you could have made was recognizing there was an issue with Larry Nassar, getting the victims the help they needed, and getting Larry the help he needed. Because who knows, if someone with a little molecule of wisdom with power at Michigan State would have decided to make a difference, hundreds of lives would be different today, including his. I am disappointed, and you should be too. Aside from the money, your reputation throughout all of these cases is going down so much. Whether it is from someone coming up to my brother at the gym, wearing an MSU sweatshirt, saying, "I can't believe you support those rapists," or other people believing that the university has lower standards and therefore is less of a school and easier to get into, your reputation is tarnished in that area. I truly believe this, but it does not mean that all the people here are bad. There's so many great doctors and workers and students working hard every day to make the world a better place, yet they have the shadow of one man hanging over them. I do not feel pity because you knew what you had coming, and that is all I have to say about Michigan State. If I have learned a few things from this journey that is far from over, it is this. One, I am going to move on and forget about you. Two, you will never hurt me or anyone again. Three, I can be a voice and a person that people can feel comfortable talking to in similar situations. Four, even when I feel low and weak, I will only come out stronger. Five, I am never alone no matter what. Six, money will not change what has been done, and there is serious work that needs to be done about sexual abuse and more change in the world we live in. Seven, I will grow to be a powerful woman with a voice to be heard. Eight, the bad guy never wins. Nine, I can only grow from here. And 10, my last tears have already been shed over you. Now, Larry, a few last thoughts. When you go to the doctor's office, feeling sick or hurt, as you may recall from your old job, a common question is to rate your pain on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being nothing and 10 being the most pain you've ever felt. I always would say no matter how much pain I was in, at my worst, I was at a 7, 8, or 9. And congrats, you got the first ever 10. For this part, I ask you to look at me in the eyes and listen to what I have to say, because it is the least I deserve in this moment. I do hope you find peace praying to God, because that is the only conversations you will get. It's my job to forgive you, but not to reconcile. That part is up to God and you in heaven, and you talking to try to get to heaven, and your willingness to listen and answer. Now that I have gotten through most of this speech and faced all of my fears and I'm ready to put you in the past, I can say, I forgive you. I don't want to hear anything else, and I am done. I survived the hospital, the MRIs, the x-rays, all the other tests, the physical therapy, and the countless numbers of doctors. And now I have survived you, not as a doctor, which was a right you should have lost over 20 years ago, but as a molester. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that statement. It was pretty amazing. I think you've grown into a very powerful young woman already. Many of your comments and your statements are not appropriate for me as a judge to weigh in on or discuss, but you've certainly raised a lot of issues to give pause of people to think about. I do hope that coming forward in this manner has been helpful to you. I thank your parents for allowing you to be here today and to share your story. And I think there is no more appropriate time for us to take a lunch break. Ms. Wickenhoff?
All right.